Good morning. We're speaking to you from the top of the Board of Trade building overlooking LaSalle Street in downtown Chicago, the dynamic center of business, industry, and finance for the Midwest. Here, Channel 26 has established the financial news headquarters with the Stock Market Observer. You are that observer, and you'll see the fascinating story of the nation's economy today unfolding before your eyes.
Good morning. This is Thursday morning, October 21st, 1971. The Market Reprise is brought to you by U.S. Steel. Let's take a look at yesterday's boards and find out what exactly did happen. As far as the boards are concerned, we'll have an interpretation of this later on in the program. As you can tell, we opened on the upside. We got up to 0.95 and then started to slide down by 10:30 or so. We were down 3.36 when word came that the prime rate had been cut from 6% to 5.75%, and up we went, but not very far, only to 1.31 before we started to slide back down again, and the lowest we got was 13.72, and then, of course, things happened, because at 2.30, we started punching up the Quotron machine, and we found out that we'd recovered slightly, as you can see by our boards now. The industrials closed down 12.78 at 855.65. Transportation, which had been down 125 and up 0.36, closed down 2.28 at 232.84. Now, they had been down 282 and recovered considerably there. This is the lowest the utilities did all day, but it took a while to get there. They were down 48, went up to 0.35, and then down to 58, and closed down 0.61 at 114.04. We had a minus tick at one point that went up to 7.11, but that was way late in the day after we had started our way back down again. A plus tick of 202 after the word came through on the cut in the prime rate. The volume, 16,340,000 shares, about, 3,300,000 better than Tuesday's closing volume figure. The overall value down 1.23%. Now, it had been only 5,200. It recovered completely, and this is where it ended up, 1.23 after that slide started around 11 o'clock yesterday morning. Those issues showing strength up on average 0.26%. Those showing weakness down on average 1.49% with a volatility index of 175. Our trading figures showed the declines led the advances 65% to 19%, 328 advancing, 1,097 declining, and 271 unchanged. That's 16%. The down volume led up volume better than 6 to 1, 79% to 12%, with 2,030,000 shares having been traded in these 328 issues advancing, 13,050,000 shares having been traded in these 1,097 issues declining. We'll take a look at the American board, a look at the Amex, after this word from U.S. Steel.
Not every school is this crowded, but we need more classrooms. At U.S. Steel, we're helping relieve our crowded schools. We're involved. In Burlington, New Jersey, we used our own low-cost panel system to put up a six-building campus in just 53 working days. Library, classrooms, labs, the works. We're helping relieve crowded schools. At United States Steel, we're involved.
Trading on the American followed the pattern very much that the New York took yesterday. The declines led the advances better than 4-1, 64% to 15%, with 21% unchanged, 175 advancing, 738 declining, 243 unchanged, and down volume also led up volume better than 6-1, 76% to 12%. 540,000 shares having been traded in these 175 issues advancing, 3,370,000 shares having been traded in these 738 issues declining. The overall value had been down 5,900s. And then in one posting alone, this read a plus 42 when word on the prime cut came along. But then we came back again and went all the way down to 1.83 at close with a volatility index of 251. Those issues showing strength up on average 3,400ths of 1 percentage point. Those showing weakness down on average 2 1/17ths of 1 percentage point, for the volatility index once again, for some of these two figures, 251. The American index closed down 0.26 at 25.92. The New York index, by the way, was down 72 cents at $52.85. We had a minus tick that was much more tenacious yesterday, 440, 440 on the minus side, with the volume 4,290,000 shares, just a little over 100,000 over Tuesday's volume figure. Well, the market reprise has been brought to you by U.S. Steel. For yesterday, today, and tomorrow, this segment of the program is brought to you by Lamson Brothers. Here to introduce his guests is your moderator, Jack Hosty.
Good morning. Welcome to yesterday, today, and tomorrow. On your left, we have Alan Grigg from Lamson Brothers, who is one of the Lamson Brothers ACE registered representatives. And on your right is William Carr, a partner of Lamson Brothers. He's the fellow who signs our paychecks, so we have to be nice to Bill here this morning. Luckily for our first day on yesterday, today, and tomorrow, we had what could be mildly called as a rather interesting yesterday. The market opened up, we were down about 2 or 3 points, and suddenly the Morgan Guaranty Trust came through and cut the prime rate. While it was kind of expected, it's still basically bullish news in the market. So the market turned around and rallied from that minus point to being up, almost 2 points on the market. Then a funny thing happened on the way to the bank. Somebody pulled the string. Down we went, and we continued to go down till we closed just about on the lowest ebb of the day, down almost 13 points on the Dow Jones Industrials. So, and since Alan switched to be a little bearish here about 2 weeks ago, unfortunately very correctly, maybe Alan could give us a few comments on what he thought happened yesterday.
Well, I think you had something similar to a small selling climax toward the end of the day. I think most of the, there hasn't been any strong buying in the market for about 2 weeks, simply because you're getting a tremendous pull of new investment money into the long-term bond market and into certificates of deposit and savings accounts and so on and so forth. On a trading basis, the market severely oversold. As of yesterday's lows, it was down about 60 points in 10 days, so we could have a rally here in, you know, any time today or tomorrow that might last for a week or so.
You've been kind of looking for one for the last
day or so.
Because
it's getting oversold, and we've had too large of a percentage decline.
Right.
But until you get a change in the international monetary situation or some progress there, you're not going to get a strong rally in the market or an increase in consumer spending here at home.
What do you think the effect of the heavy cash-in rate of the mutual funds have been on this market? That seemed to be the piece of bad news.
Yeah, that kind of broke the camel's back, but I don't regard that as being too significant right now. I think if you study it, you'll probably find the rate of redemptions is pretty much normal, whereas the rate of new buying isn't what it used to be. So it gives you a net withdrawal.
Right, that rather ties in.
But it scares people.
Oh, certainly.
Because they envision billions of dollars worth of stuff being liquidated, you know.
Well, doesn't that tie into your thinking that there's been a shift of customer money into savings and loans and CDs? And, of course, what would it chiefly affect but the mutual fund, right?
Yes, and stock purchases.
Right.
No.
Does it seem
when the market gets weak, the professional money just stays on the sidelines all that longer.
So you think we're getting a sideline of professional money and kind of a lack of interest?
A buildup, yes, but nothing aggressive right yet. Until they see a rally, then it'll feed on itself for a week or so.
Right. Do you think that if we get a rally, it'll last a while, Al?
A week or two.
Well,
you're not going to get a sustained rally in the market until you clear up the international monetary situation or until you see some visible statistical evidence here at home that the economy's recovering rather than faltering.
I see. In other words, third quarter earnings, every time we've gotten some benefits, they seem to really...
That's already past history.
Yeah, they seem to dump it.
We've had two-thirds of the earnings reports have been good lately, but right now the market's not in the mood to pay attention to them. I think later on it'll pay attention to them.
When I had a program here in 26, I used to use a phrase, the half-full bottle of water. The optimist says it's half-full and the pessimist says
it's
half-empty.
Right.
And that's about what they're doing with third-quarter earnings here, wouldn't you say?
Right.
They're all looking
they
at the
no
bad ones.
They have no significant effect right now. They will later.
How about you yesterday, Bill? The view from on high?
I think you had a couple of things, Jack. I think, first of all, the prime rate was in the market, as they say, and I think that it was an excuse, really, now that it's happened, now that the news has been broken, it was a good excuse to sell. I think another factor that we've been seeing here is a technical breakdown in your averages, and I think you've broken a number of minor support areas. And in my opinion, a lot of people are looking at the 840 now as probably a place to stop. And my feeling is, at least on a temporary basis, it will stop before then. And I think we'll just have to see a number of events take place that'll guide our thinking whether we'll go through it or not.
What do you think led to the disappointment, really, if that be the phrase, over the prime interest cut yesterday?
I don't think it's a disappointment as such. I think it's just something that's expected and in the market. The bond market, as you know, has been very strong for the last couple of weeks. And your utility market had, I believe it was 11 straight days of an up market. It has broken the last few days, of course. But all this has been reflected in the market, and as I said before, I think it's just an excuse.
What do you think that's going to happen, oh, let's say, in the near term to the averages? Do you think, agree with Alan, that we're overdue for a technical rally? It seems to be a unanimous opinion on the street.
Well, I don't think we're going to go through the 840 mark right away, even though we're only 15 points away from it. When you get a break such as we had yesterday of 13 points, you've got to say you're near the 840 breaking points when you can break that hard and that fast. My feeling is that you'll probably get a technical pullback, probably a few 5 to 10 points, and then eventually I think you'll test the 840.
Well, I think it's one of those things, if they could guarantee to us, Bill, that 840 was the bottom, we could all go home and get a little better night's sleep tonight. Now, if we can interview a slight commercial message here. Lamson Brothers every year prepares a tax letter. Guess who writes it?
Couldn't be Uncle Jack.
I do, so I like to push my own product. They gave me a choice this morning. But seriously, it goes back to a letter that I've been writing for about 6 years. In the last 2 years, I've had the invaluable help of one Charles Doherty, who is an outstanding tax expert. It runs five pages, now that I think of it, and gives you some straight tax advice. It doesn't deal in generalities. It gets right down to the nitty-gritty of what you should do here to save yourself some tax money. We also make an offer of a pamphlet right in our tax letter. So if you'd like to get a copy of Lamson Brothers' annual end-of-the-year tax letter, please write to Lamson Brothers, L-A-M-S-O-N, Brothers, 141 141 West Jackson, Chicago, Illinois, 60604. Lamson Brothers will be glad to send you a free copy with no obligation of Lamson Brothers' tax letter. If on the envelope or the card that you mail, you will simply write the word tax, T-A-X, we'll know what you want and we'll send it out immediately. It's going to press on Friday. It will be ready for distribution beginning Monday, and we will get it to you early next week. So again, if you want a free copy of Lamson's tax letter, just write to Lamson Brothers, 141 West Jackson, Chicago, 60604. Put tax on the envelope or the card, and we'll be glad to send you a free copy. Now, to return to the subject at hand, what the market is going to do from here, I was trying to get the experts' opinion, so I ran over everybody else's opinion on the street off the wires this morning. And it seems that, I don't think Alan did, but he came up with a consensus of the feeling of most of the people in the business. They all seem to be using the same phrase that you used, Alan, and that is the technical rally. Could you maybe explain to everybody out there just why a technical rally is imminent at this point and maybe what a technical rally is?
Well, a technical rally simply is that the selling pressures run their course and somebody comes in and buys 500 of this or 500 of that, and they see an uptick, and pretty soon all the boardroom traders and the floor traders see the thing starting to recover. When you have we had a 60-point decline in 10 days, and a lot of stocks, a lot of growth stocks especially, are off like 5 to 10%. And you just create a vacuum above them. Number one, this break hasn't been caused by selling. It's been caused by a lack of demand. Yesterday was the only day we had any significant selling pressure. And after something's down 10 or 15%, and the selling comes in and more or less washes itself out and gets itself over with. It's just like a ball. When it hits the floor, it's going to bounce back up at least part way. And that's what a technical rally is. It's about as simple as that. It creates a vacuum in one on coming down, and then it goes back up and fills part of that vacuum. But we haven't been in the kind of liquidating bear market that we had a year and a half ago.
No,
we will be. We're simply in a market where there's no rampant demand for the Dow Jones type securities, and everybody watches the Dow Jones.
Right.
There will be until you're getting too much money siphoned off into the long-term bond market and savings accounts and so on and so forth.
But eventually, this money has a way of seeping back into
working
the market.
Working its way back. Yes.
Right.
When
another
stocks
word,
again look attractive compared to whatever they'll pay them for the money.
Right, because banks will eventually loan money to insurance companies who eventually seek their way back into equities.
Oh, it'll cycle back in.
Well, I think the phenomena that we saw a year ago May, if that be the what you were talking about, that May of 1970
well,
the
bear
final
market
turnaround.
Lasted about a year and a half due to liquidation, and it finally ran its course, and you cooled back up,
right.
And you began a process of reaccumulation, which I think temporarily has stopped. I think it'll resume again later,
right.
A month or two.
In other words, you're looking for about the same thing that Bill Carr was talking about, perhaps a testing of the 840 resistance level and then some strength from there.
Yeah.
Also, I think a basically bullish thing that we have going on in the market now is that, as Bill Carr said, we have an excellent bond market. Now, if you recall here about a year and a half ago, suddenly the yields on good securities were getting up around 10% on new issues, simply because there was no cash around to put into the corporate coffers.
Right.
But now we seem to have a surplus of this type of cash, where people have the money and corporations have the money, and they're going in a non-equity situation so that we don't have this tremendous drying up of that kind of money. This, of course, augurs well for the long-term pull of the market. What do you think about that, Bill?
Well, I think it does, Jack. There's an interesting article in the Journal this morning, too, that is the other side of the coin, and that is, eventually, your payoff in stocks is on earnings per share. Your growth stocks, year in and year out, have outperformed the market because their earnings have outperformed other kinds of investments. And as long as the earnings are going up, those stocks eventually will go up. Now, they don't go up in a straight line, as we all know. That would make a very easy game.
Yes.
It would eliminate us, as a matter of fact. But I think the final payoff will be when a stock is increasing its earnings 10, 12, 15% a year, and you can look ahead to 1972, 1973 earnings, and a stock today is selling at 20 times those earnings. It probably is pretty cheap, assuming that those earnings have been there year after year. As I say, I'm not really answering your question about the bond market, but it is the other side of the coin, and unless people can see that kind of an earnings power coming in behind the stock, they're going to put their money in bonds.
And
why
this is
not?
Kind of what's happened as we have gotten a few weak quarters in here. IBM came out with a flat quarter just about the earnings report before this, and I think they dropped them, what, 20, 25 points in 3 days?
More like 40 or 50.
Well, in three days, they took that much off of them.
The reason
and all they did was come out with a flat quarter. They had been so used to IBM escalating quarter after quarter.
The reason the bond market is so strong, I think, for already existing bonds is the flow of new bonds coming is decreasing because corporations have been building up liquidity for 2 years, and the new issuance of bonds is slowing down in the dollar amount. And the public or the medium-sized investors are running in for 8 and a fraction percent long bonds while they last on the idea that, you know, they're
this won't be around too long,
right, and that the government won't allow an interest rate to go up, but conceivably it could go down. So I think that's what's pulling money into it. Eventually they're going to be reversed, and within a few months or whatever time period it takes, they're going to pay. There's growth stocks, traditional growth stocks right now that are selling maybe 10, 12, 15 times earnings that for 15 years have carried a 25, 30 P.E.
Right, and they're historically bargains at this point,
yes. I mean,
money will come in.
They seem to be historically. Eventually, the money's going to cycle back in, and they'll again outperform the Dow Jones, just like Bill Carr said. If you could construct an index of IBM, Xerox, a dresser graph, and stocks like that, you'd find that the thing on a chart would probably go 10 times as high as the Jones has, you know, in the last 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, it's more violent on the downside because you're dealing with a higher P.E. But
right.
as long as the earnings are delivered or they get in a bad year or two where they have flat or lower earnings, if they can reverse themselves again and renew their growth, eventually they're going to outperform the Jones 3-1.
Then back up we go.
Sure.
One more commercial word while we're working in here. The Nuveen tax-exempt bond fund is a something that should probably be looked at by almost every investor. If you're in a high tax bracket, this can afford you tax-free income on a mutual fund basis where it's registered in your name and you collect twice monthly checks. You can't say too much about a mutual fund on the air because it's for sale by prospectus only. But if you would write in to Lamson Brothers, L-A-M-S-O-N, Brothers at 141 West Jackson, Chicago 60604, and put Nuveen, N-U-V-E-E-N, on your letter, we'll be more than glad to send you a free copy of the prospectus and sales literature on the Nuveen tax-exempt bond fund. So, we're about to wrap up our program here. It's been awfully good being with you on the first Yesterday, Today, and Tomorrow show. I'd like to thank Alan Grigg, who's on your left here, who's with Lamson Brothers. I think you wouldn't mind if some of the listeners called you up this morning and wanted to chat with you at Wabash 2-2400. Alan Grigg will be glad to talk to you. On your right is Bill Carr, who is a partner of Lamson Brothers. He, too, would be available for conversation with you, I'm sure, at Wabash 2-2400. So again, have a good morning. Maybe we're going to have a little bit better day on the market. Thank you for tuning in, and goodbye.
Our thanks to you, Jack. Yesterday, Today, and Tomorrow, a look at the world of business has been brought to you today by Lamson Brothers, offices in the Chicago Board of Trade. Time for a look at some of the late world headlines early this Thursday, October 21st of 1971. Good morning. Ed Ballantine and Ben Larson here will be giving you a summary of what happened in financial headlines as well as the world. The world, first of all, we're informed that U.S. combat deaths in Vietnam last week were the lowest in more than 6 years. A U.S. command reports that five Americans died in battle over that seven-day accounting period. Strangely enough, the communist negotiations at the Vietnam peace talks now being held in Paris are now accusing the United States of actually stepping up the action in that Asian nation. They claim that the United States now plans to bring in more troops from some of its Pacific bases. India, Pakistan, at it again, they've exchanged counterclaims concerning the situation along their frontier, each accusing the other about hostile action along their borders. And a Washington newspaper, picked up by some of our Chicago newspapers, this one is the Post that we refer to, says that an American Bar Association group weighing the merits of six potential nominees to the Supreme Court has turned down two of the front runners, or has at least advised against them. Publication says that the panel has already advised the White House to that effect. Now, this just headline news. Douglas will have a complete summary for you at about 15 minutes past 9 o'clock. And Ed Ballantine will have a little review of financial headlines in a moment on a Stock Market Observer.
Let's peek into a window. A window that looks into an airline computer. Ozark's computer. When you call Ozark Airlines, this amazing machine gives instant answers to your questions about flights, seat availability, connecting service. Then we key your name and reservation into its memory, and you become unforgettable. Sure, computerized reservations is a big airline service. Ozark is up there with the biggest.
Good morning. We have business headlines, our business news highlights at this hour now for you. London gold, $42.5.25, unchanged. Sterling eases in London. The dollar steady on the Paris free market and the dollar lower at Tokyo. The dollar was firmer in Frankfurt. Toyo Kogyo says talks with Ford on tie-up temporarily suspended. French residents allowed to buy securities on foreign exchanges. Japan to float yen for, quote, considerable time, ministers say. Danish parliament approves 10% import surcharge. Hitachi tells Paris, Hitachi and Fujitsu agree to coordinate computer operations. Hanoi tells Paris talks Nixon plans to step up war in Indochina. Westinghouse said to agree on nuclear fuel venture with Japanese firms. Getty Oil Australian venture, Crown Zellerbach in Japanese synthetic pulp venture. Euroclear and Sedell implement working agreement. Dollar fixed higher in Frankfurt and the French visible assets decline. Those are news highlights of the hour, and here's Ben now with the weather.
Just briefly, if you've looked outside this morning, it looks quite overcast. However, there's only a 20% chance for rain predicted by the weatherman today under Pretty sunny and warm skies later on this afternoon, with a high expected to get all the way up to 80 degrees. It's 64 downtown, 66 northwest, 67 at Midway. We have a relatively high humidity now at 73%, and the wind is out of the southeast at just 4 miles an hour. More information for you in a moment on the Stock Market Observer.
This Friday afternoon, you're going to be able to stop swimming upstream, because that's when the weekend begins. Time to just drift along with the current. Time to enjoy the good things of life, the best.
If you've got the time, we've got the beer.
Miller beer.
Miller tastes too good to hurry. It's time to relax. Miller stands clear.
Beer after beer.
If you've got the time.
If you've got the time.
We've got the beer.
Miller beer.
If you've got the time.
Good morning. Here are the New York 10 most active, and then after that, the 10 most up on the New York, and then the 10 most down. I'm Susan Plumridge, and the top 10 are brought to you by Coca-Cola. At the top of the list, National Can closed at 19. It was off 4.25 for the day on volume of 301,300 shares. First National City Corporation closed at 40.875. It was off 1 on volume of 169,700 shares. General Electric closed at 60. That was off 1.75 on volume of 156,900 shares. American Telephone and Telegraph closed at 42.25, off 5/8 on volume of 152,900 shares. Great Western Financial closed at 30.5, and that was up 7/8 on volume of 152,100 shares. Caterpillar Tractor closed at 43.5, off 2.125 for the day on volume of 145,300 shares. Northern National Gas closed at 47, off 1/8 on a volume of 118,100 shares. Occidental Petroleum closed at 14.25, off 0.5 on volume of 117,600 shares. Teledyne closed at 18.875, off 1.375 on volume of 111,000 shares. DeSoto Incorporated closed at 19.375, off 3.125 on volume of 107,400 shares. Ford Motor Company closed at 69.875, off 5/8 for the day on volume of 105,300 shares. And Bud Company closed at 10.75, off 0.5 on volume of 104,600. American Hospital closed at 39.75 and was unchanged for the day on volume of 101,600 shares.
I'd like to buy the world a home and furnish it with love. Grow apple trees and honeybees and snow white turtle doves. I'd like to teach the world to sing.
Sing with me.
You'll notice out of the 10 most active, only one issue was up, and that was Great Western Financial. All the others were down. And now the 10 most up on the New York. Northgate is at the top of the list. It closed at 5.875, where it was up 3/4. Percentage gain was 14.6. Allied Supermarkets closed at 7, was up 5/8. Percentage gain was 9.8. Dictaphone closed at 7.625, up 0.5 for the day, and percentage gain was 7%. International Industries closed at 4.75, up 0.25, and percentage gain was 5.6 there. USM, $1.50 preferred stock, was closed at 20, up 1 for the day. up 5.3%. Chad Bourne Preferred Stock closed at 5.25, up a quarter, up 5% for the day. And Chris Kraft Preferred Series C Stock closed at 16, up 3/4, up 4.9%. Webb Company closed at 18, up 3/4 for the day, also up 4.9%. And Alco Standard closed at 16.75, up 3/4 for the day, up 4.7%. American Water Works closed at 23, up 1, up 4.5%. And at the top of the list, of course, was Northgate with the most in gains, 14.6% in gains, up 3/4. The highest dollar-wise was USM $1.50 preferred stock. That was up 1 full point for the day. And now the 10 most down on the New York Stock Exchange. National Chem at the top of the list closed at 19, down 4.25 for the day. Percentage loss was 18.3. National Chem Preferred Series A stock closed at 35, down 7.25 for the day, down 17%, 17.2% to be exact. Natoma's closed at 56, and that loss was 9.78. Percentage loss, 15%. DeSoto Incorporated closed at 19.38, down 3.18 for the day, down 13.9%. Scott Paper Company closed at 15.75, down 2.8. Percentage loss, 11.9%. Crowell Collier Preferred Stock closed at 19, down 2, down 9.5%. Hemisphere Fund closed at 3.75, down 3/8 for the day, down 9.1%. Engelhard Minerals and Chemicals, and this is their preferred, closed at 155, down 15 for the day, down 8.8%. Dynamic American closed at 8.375, down 3/4, down 8.2% for the day. And Con Leasing closed at 8.75, down 3/4, down 7.9%. And that is your 10 most active, along with your 10 most up and 10 most down on the New York Stock Exchange.